If you're the kind of technician who likes to use a light bulb for automotive circuit testing, or if you're just curious as to why anybody would want to do that, then this video is for you. One of the most common questions that goes through a mechanic's mind before he replaces a bad part is the question as to whether the wiring is still intact. That is, could there be occult resistance in the wiring that's creating a situation where the device is not getting adequate power? Along that lines, one of the most popular screening tests is to put a simple light bulb in the circuit and see whether or not the light bulb is able to light. How good is this test? Let's explore it. Now, just to make sure everybody's on the same level, here's the circuit we're testing. Here's the battery. There's an area of unknown resistance somewhere in the line. We'll say it's right here. And here's a connector for the end device, like a fuel pump or a window regulator. That's disconnected at the moment. Now, normally there's a switch and sometimes even a relay on the ground side, but in the interest of getting the message across, we're going to show a straight connection to ground. Now, when you suspect a part is bad, you often use a multimeter to test for power and ground at the connector. So here's the question. Suppose with corrosion you have a huge area of resistance. What would a multimeter show for voltage at this point compared to ground? Yeah, 12 volts. The internal resistance of a multimeter is way too high to use that technique to measure line resistance. What you need to do is to get electrons flowing. We do that by putting a known resistance in the form of a light bulb across the connector. By getting electrons moving, the bulb drags voltage down in a series of steps at each point of resistance, and you can measure those voltage drops to calculate the unknown resistance. Now, the simplest way to test current feed to a device is to turn it on and measure voltage drop across the device, but that's often not possible. The device, by definition, is not working, and so you're not necessarily drawing enough current. A second option is to use one of these, a simple test light, preferably an incandescent test light that draws a bit of current, but this one only draws about 170 milliamps, so that's not really enough. That's why the light bulb has proven itself to be so popular. First off, I'm going to measure current draw just with the light bulb by itself. I'm using an inductive method. This is a charged 12-volt motorcycle battery, and you can see that I'm drawing about 4.4 amps to light that bulb. Okay, for this next part, I've switched over to a power supply, and this is applied voltage here, and this is measured current here, and we're just hooked up to the light bulb. Now, I want to answer two questions here. The first question is, how much voltage does it take to turn this light bulb on? And secondly, is there a gradual variation in brightness depending on how much voltage is applied? Let's see. So I'm going to turn the voltage up slowly. And we're up to about 0.5 volts, and I can't see any brightness there, even though we've got about 1 amp flowing. So that's my first point, is that you can certainly have current flowing through the bulb without seeing it in terms of brightness. But as I increase, we're about 1.3 volts, and I don't know if you can perceive it, but I can see a bit of a glow in that bulb already. We've got about 1.3 amps flowing. And as I gradually increase the voltage, we get an increase in brightness, which is what we want. We want to be able to see that subjective change. Now here we're about 7 volts, and we've got about 3.0 amps flowing. Now, the limitation of this power supply is it won't let me go over about 3.5 amps, and so I'm not going to be able to carry this all the way to the top. But I think you'll appreciate that at the high end, it's quite difficult to subjectively decide whether or not you've got full amperage flowing in that circuit. Now let's go to a graph I made from data with the light bulb and the power supply. There's something very interesting going on here. You saw me taking readings of voltage and current through the bulb, and each point on this curve is one reading. I've plotted voltage on the horizontal axis, and I calculated resistance from Ohm's law on the vertical axis. As you know, a simple resistor would show a flat line, since resistance in a resistor doesn't vary with current. But that's not so with a light bulb. Recall that below about 1 volt, the bulb wasn't lit, and above about 6 volts, the bulb was glowing brightly. It may be a bit hard to tell when full current is flowing at the high end, because in a dim garage, anything above 6 volts is bright. Is that a problem? Now, at the 6 volt mark, we measured 2.2 ohms of resistance. That's pretty small. Most circuits are built with enough reserve that a couple of ohms of line resistance is negligible. Now let's take a minute and play devil's advocate. Would a LoadPro be any better? Here's what the same circuit would look like with a LoadPro with 25.9 ohms here. Let's assume for the moment you still have 2.2 ohms of circuit resistance here. So from Ohm's law, current would be 0.43 amps, and again from Ohm's law, the drop across the LoadPro would be 11 volts, or a drop of about 1 volt. Now, those of us who use the LoadPro use a general rule of thumb that a drop of less than 1 volt is not usually significant, so we'd be in that same equivocal ballpark as with a light bulb. It's not better than a light bulb for a high amperage circuit. There's something more interesting that goes against the LoadPro here. Because the LoadPro added extra resistance to the circuit, we were testing at a much reduced amperage, 0.43 amps compared to 2.7 amps. Now, it could be that resistance from corrosion in a circuit might behave like a resistor, but I believe areas of corrosion are more likely to behave like a light bulb, with increasing resistance as your current increases and the corroded area heats up. So, supposing at low current levels your corrosion only adds 1 ohm of circuit resistance, well then total current is 0.446 amps, and the voltage drop across the LoadPro increases to 11.6 volts, putting us well into the equivocal range. The LoadPro is not better. I've got one last conceptual point that may help you to visualize Ohm's Law. In the DC automotive circuits we work with, voltage is fixed, usually around 5 or 12 volts. So you can simplify Ohm's Law to a fixed product of resistance and current. Here I've plotted total resistance of a circuit on the horizontal axis and current through the circuit on the vertical axis. You can see the curve takes on an intriguing hyperbolic shape with a vertical arm and a horizontal arm. If you increase the voltage, you shift the curve to the upper right, but you don't change the hyperbolic shape. Here are the 5, 12, and 24 volt curves to compare. Those circuits that need to perform physical work have to sit on the vertical part of the curve. For example, the starter motor and alternator work on the very high end of the scale, and even the fuel pump would sit in the 6 amp territory. Recall that power output is a product of current and voltage, so with a fixed voltage, the only way to increase power delivery is to increase current. These circuits do that by having a low resistance, typically just a few ohms. Notice how steep this part of the graph is, which means that even a couple of ohms of extra circuit resistance from corrosion could be enough to dramatically reduce current and power delivery. So these circuits are built with very large wires to reduce line resistance and to handle the heat generated at connection points. The steepness of this vertical arm also explains why you can't rely on any general rule of thumb regarding how much extra circuit resistance is tolerable. Now look at the horizontal part of the curve. This is where most automotive circuits live. These are low current, narrow gauge signal wires. They live on the signal side of relays and sensors. The 5 volt reference circuit lives way off the scale to the right with an internal 5,000 ohm resistor to protect the PCM from excessive current. Notice that the flat slope of this side of the curve means you can have a big change in resistance without causing any meaningful change in current. Of course, we can also use this graph to describe our tools. When set to measure voltage, the multimeter is way off the chart to the right, with about 1 million ohms built into the meter. An incandescent test light is usually a little better, but even so, mine sits off the scales with a 70 ohm resistance, resulting in a 170 milliamp draw. The LoadPro is further to the left with just over 25 ohms. But you don't start to climb into the vertical part of the scale until you reach for the diagnostic headlight, a high amp diagnostic tool drawing 4.4 amps here. With its high amp draw, the variance of brightness with changing current can be more dramatic than with a test light. So if high amp diagnostic tools are better, why don't we use them all the time? Well, it's because they're not safe for circuits that aren't designed for high current. The last thing you want to do is let the smoke out of expensive computer parts when doing ill-advised diagnostic testing. So, general diagnostic tools are designed to work safely in most circuits, even if they're somewhat underpowered for high current situations. Well, it comes down to an old and recurring life lesson. That is that a tradesman needs to know his tools, and he needs to match his tools appropriately with a situation. Now, we know that if this bulb glows brightly, we know we've got at least 3 amps flowing, with a smooth transition down to 1 amp where it turns off. If you need a more exacting detail, you can do voltage drops across the bulb or even measure current across the bulb for more detail. Or, better yet, use your end device for current and drop testing. In this case, I'm measuring current draw from a fuel pump and I'm getting much more diagnostic information. But that's a topic for another day. Thanks for watching.